wants to meet with us and wants to speak to us this morning. And so, Lord, we pray that everything we do this morning, we will hear your voice, we will hear you speak to us personally, we'll hear you speak to us in the situations we're in, and that we will come out of this meeting and come from this place knowing that we've met with you, that we're changed and transformed by you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. I'm going to give a couple of quick notices to make a start with this morning. First is a bit of an advance notice. Next Sunday is our monthly prayer and praise meeting. We'll be meeting on Zoom again at 6:30, and the details for that will be in your bulletin, so please keep an eye out for that. It's a really great time to meet together. Even though we're not together, we can still meet together and really pray and lift things up to Christ, which is a great thing to do. If you are not with us this morning as well, we do want to hear the voice of God, as I said, and I want to encourage you, if you're not here in the building, or even if you are here in the building and you feel like God is speaking to you and has something to share, either directly with the church or you're not sure, please just text in, or if you've got any prayer requests, the number is 07851 992060. If you're watching at home, it'll be going along the bottom of your screen and be in the bottom corner as well. And we really want to hear from God today, and that's the best way that we can then share that and share that with the rest of the congregation as well. We like to celebrate birthdays in the church, and particularly significant birthdays we like to share and celebrate. June was 80 this week, and so just so that the church know, we presented June with a planter for her garden to wish her a happy birthday and to celebrate with her while we're still unable to be together. She was very grateful for that, and it was really gratefully received. So we just wanted to make sure that as a church we know that we have celebrated with June, and she was very grateful for everyone's kind words on her birthday as well. And finally, we've got a video from John and Rachel. Anyone who doesn't know John and Rachel, they are our missionaries who are based in Paraguay at the moment. They've been unable to get back for a couple of years because of COVID. So they've sent us an update about what they've been up to, how they've managed COVID and lockdown in Paraguay.
We're John.
So we will watch this, and then the worship band will come up and lead us in worship this morning.
Hello. We're John and Rachel McDonough, ELA missionaries serving in Paraguay. And for those of you that have been on this journey with us for a long time, yes, John is looking younger.
And Rach, we're actually in really well colour coordinated today, which was a mistake. But we do look like M&Ms. Anyway, we'd just like to say hello. We haven't been able to get back for nearly 2 years now to come and travel around. So we thought we'd send you a little message to give you an update on where we are, what we're doing, what God's doing, and what our hopes for the future are.
Over here in Paraguay, we had a very strict lockdown for a very long time, but during that time, we were able to go out and advance our ministry in new and different ways.
Through the giving of the ELAM relief appeal and the COVID-19 relief appeal, we were able to go into multiple communities, Indigenous First Nation communities, as well as children's homes and remote villages in Paraguay to distribute dry food and aid, but also to take a message of hope.
It was incredible to be able to get out and about when so many people were in need, and not only show them practical care, but to be able to share the love of Jesus with them.
During one of the visits to an Indigenous community, the chief of that community, the leader, invited us back once the lockdowns had eased. And one of the amazing things is we've gone back since. We'll tell you more in a bit.
So also, we were able to have a Christmas party. It hasn't been like those that we've had in previous years, but we were able to go out and celebrate the birth of our Saviour with those that have become believers over the past couple of years, and be able to distribute gifts that are practical and also beneficial to people that were not able to get out and about into towns.
What's been amazing to see at the Christmas party celebration this year was the believers sharing the gospel message with their fellow community members and sharing that hope of the incarnation of our Lord and Saviour. And so that was a real privilege for us to stand side by side with our brothers and sisters and to share that message.
And we didn't mind wearing the masks, and the people we were sharing with thought it was quite amusing that we had to all wear these masks. So as you can see in some of the photos, they were all covered, and we took extra precaution and extra care to make sure that everybody was supported and kept safe.
Social distancing protocols, hand sanitizer.
But we don't sing happy birthday to wash our hands here. See, Feliz cumpleaños.
Do you sing happy birthday when you wash your hands?
Apparently, that's what they do in the UK.
You should do that every time. Anyway, one of the great fruits that we've seen through the ERA has been opening of doors. We were welcomed back into one of the communities and able to take a group of our leaders that we're discipling from other communities into this new community to share the gospel message. And we want to celebrate with you as we look to plant another church in another community, led, discipled and encouraged by the people who we've been growing, discipling and mentoring.
It's been incredible to see people that have given their lives during the pandemic now able to fellowship together. And as things have opened up here, we've been allowed to go and meet and recongregate with the people that have become believers. And the other thing is, in Paraguay, you're allowed to meet up to 100 people if you have an outdoor social event. And
just all, so happens,
all of our churches are outside under trees. So we are now able to meet again on a Sunday. We are also able to sing, although myself and John still have to wear masks, but that's probably a
good
thing.
Better.
Yeah, I think so. And the children as well are really excited to be able to go back and mix with their friends and have that time of fellowship and experience of church again.
Over the coming months, we're very excited to see how we can utilise and develop those who we've been mentoring, growing young leaders, to adopt the strategy and approaches that we have in reaching further into communities, into different areas of Paraguay. And so please pray for us as we look to rewrite some of our discipleship material, looking at ways of clarity in communication and ease for that to be facilitated by others. Looking really to develop our material so that we can train the trainer, so that people can reutilize this, get hold of it, go to their neighbors and around and just share the simple gospel message, biblical truth of who Jesus is with people around them. So please pray for us as we develop that. It's exciting, it's cool.
And please pray for those leaders that are already starting to move forward within the congregation that have this passion to go and share their faith in other places. Please pray for protection over them and their families, as a lot of them feel they are coming under attack as they step away from the belief systems of their communities. And for our personal prayer request, please pray as we are standing in faith to get a new vehicle. We have had 2 children in the last 5 years, and that has restricted how many people we can take in the vehicle with us. And so often there are many needs to take people to hospitals, to transport people to different communities when we're doing our evangelistic outreach, and we are not able to take them with us. And we also do not want to take our children out of their car seats or to not have them travel with us. So please pray as we believe for God's provision in that area. And please pray for our old truck, which has done us so proud but is now slowly falling apart, that it will continue to serve and bless the ministry. This is the way that we facilitate our ministry, is our vehicle. So please pray for protection whilst we're on the roads too.
I believe the old truck's going to get to 500,000 miles.
It's nearly there.
Kilometres, sorry. And so from us in Paraguay, thank you so much for your support. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your emails of encouragement that you send us. Thank you for loving on us and our family with the post, which is trickling through. We've got posts from pre-pandemic, so the postal service is opening up.
And we hope that in at least 2022, we will be able to be with you physically in the UK. So please pray for us and for our families who are missing us greatly and have not yet had the chance to meet our son, Jesse. 1, 2, 3. Bye!
I'm just going to pray for John and Rachel and for the whole situation there. If you're in the building with us, stand with us as we pray together. And Ben, if you make your way up as we're praying. Father, we do thank you for John and Rachel. We thank you for the work that they are doing out in Paraguay. We thank you for their faith, for their enthusiasm, for their love for you, and for the difference and the impact they're having for you in Paraguay. And we just pray for the communities that they're reaching out to, for the communities that they're going into, that they will continue to make inroads, that they'll continue to be able to share your love and to change lives for you. Lord, we thank you that you are the one who's doing the work through John and Rachel. We pray for them as a family, for their needs, with a vehicle, and for their family who are still here in the UK who are missing them. And we just pray that you will draw close and that you will meet every need that they have, that they will continue to be able to serve you in the amazing way that they are doing at the moment. And so we just place them into your hands this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, I thought, what's that big golden ball in the sky? It's the sun. Let's praise the Lord this morning. Give him your praise. Sing the best you can. Dance. I know it's hard with your masks on. I was thinking John had a great big black mask on there, but he's grown a beard, I think. There is an endless song echoes in. By the King this morning, you are loved. Yeah.
is filled with his glory. It's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. Together we sing. There's none like you. There's none like you. Rest in that oil.
such a good Father. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before.
Sing like never before.
Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Sun comes up.
The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing.
singing, I just get this sense of God saying, singing about me being perfect, and I am perfect. But that doesn't mean you have to be perfect to know my love. John 3:16 said, for God so loved the world, he gave his only son. Doesn't say he loved those in the world who were perfect. Doesn't say he loved those in the world who were good. Says he loved the world. He loves you this morning. And I think God just wants to remind you that you don't have to be perfect to be loved by him. You don't have to be perfect to receive his love. Stop dwelling on the things that are not right about you or about your life. Just receive his love this morning. Just receive his grace. And he will make you better. He will begin to heal. He will begin to restore. He will begin to renew your soul and your spirit. You don't have to be perfect to be loved by God. He is perfect. His love is perfect. You don't have to be. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
O sacred King. O sacred King. Holy King. O holy King. How can I honor you rightly? Honor that's right for your name. Sacred friend. Oh, holy friend. I don't take what you give. Instead of disgrace, for it's the mystery of the universe. You're the God of holiness, and yet you welcome souls like me. And with the blessing of your Father's heart, you discipline the ones you love. There's kindness in your mercy. To recognize your power, know just how wonderful you are, that you draw.
invite Seedlings, who's our youngest age group, to make their way out. But before we do, I've had a word share where someone has just got the word bound in their head and feels like God's saying us, we're his chosen people, we are bound to him, there's nothing that can separate us from that love. And we, as we're bound to him, we can come and just worship him and give him the praise that he deserves. And we don't need to have anything holding us back, because what we're bound to is the living God and our Lord and Saviour. So I'm going to pray for that. I'm going to ask Seedlings to make their way out. I think you guys know where you're going by now. And I'll pray for our young people as well as they head out. So Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are chosen by you, that you freely give us grace and you freely give us that relationship with you. And Lord, I just pray for each of us that we will give you the praise that you deserve as your loving children. Lord, I pray for our young people, for our kids who are making their way out now, for our kids in Two Forks Tribe and for our young people in Face to Faith, that as they are being taught this morning, that they will hear your voice, that they will encounter the living God. I pray for wisdom for the teachers who are teaching, that they will speak truth and speak your love into those lives. And I pray for Alan as he comes and shares your word with us this morning, that his words won't be words of man, but will be words from your spirit and the words that come from you. So Lord, open our hearts as well as our ears this morning to hear from you. In Jesus' name, amen.
There you go. Can you hear me now? Could you not hear me before? Be honest now, with my voice, you can... Oh, you couldn't. Okay. The deaf ones at the back couldn't hear me. That's fine. Okay, good to see you. Great to have you with us if you're visiting us, because each week, even though we've only got a third to a little bit more of our congregation out, every week we have visitors among us. So if you're visiting us today, we give you a really warm welcome. We should have had two or three. I know one cancelled, but if there's a couple of visitors here, we give you a warm welcome. I can't tell whether you're a visitor or not with these masks on. Some of you look a lot better with your mask on, I hasten to add, but that's fine. Just if you're sitting next to somebody, nudge them and say, he's talking about you. You look better with your mask on. Go on, do it. Go on, Trevor, I dare you. I dare you. Okay, turn with me in the scriptures, if you will, to 1 Corinthians and chapter 7. And we're going to read together from 1 Corinthians 7 and verse 29. If you want to follow it in your electronic device or printed Bible, that's great. If you want to have a look at it on the screen, that's fine. It'll appear in just a moment. There we go. 1 Corinthians 7:29. Paul speaking to the Corinthian church about the whole area of marriage and some of the ancillary things associated with that, says this. What I mean, brothers, is that the time is short. From now on, those who have wives should live as if they had none. Those who mourn as if they did not. Those who are happy as if they were not. Those who buy something as if it were not theirs to keep. Those who use the things of this world as if not engrossed in them, for this world in its present form is passing away. I would like you to be free from concern. An unmarried man is concerned about the Lord's affairs, how he can please the Lord, but a married man is concerned about the affairs of this world, how he can please his wife, and his interests are divided. An unmarried woman or virgin is concerned about the Lord's affairs. Her aim is to be devoted to the Lord in both body and spirit, but a married woman is concerned about the affairs of this world, how she can please her husband. I'm saying this for your own good, not to restrict you, but that you may live in a right way in undivided devotion to the Lord. And in this church at Corinth that Paul had founded, he's writing to them about 18 months, 2 years after he'd been there, establishing the church. All sorts of things had gone on in the church. they were infiltrated and affected by the culture in which they existed. And there were extremes within the church. There was some boasting about their sexual conquests and their liberty in the sexual area. And we looked at that a few weeks back. And then there were others who were saying, hang on a wee minute, anything to do with the body is sinful. We should be spiritual. And they had this separation between the spiritual and the physical. And so they were asking questions of a whole host of things. Now, we've got to recognize that between those two extremes, there was probably a large majority somewhere in the middle. You seldom find truth in extremes, whether it's politics, whether it's specific issues that polarize people. It's almost always somewhere in the middle. It's seldom black or white, it's always gray. And so it is when we try and handle scripture in a simplistic way. You know, somebody has a problem and you give them a verse that it just trips out. But it's not always the whole truth. It's sometimes only a partial truth. And we need to make sure that we balance what scripture says. Paul had heard what was going on in the church. And so the first part of his book, he's writing to sort them out on issues that they've got wrong, but he's also responding to a previous letter they've sent him about some of the questions they had. And they had a whole list of them. They're asking, should married couples have sex with each other? They were saying, shouldn't they abstain from sex? Isn't that more spiritual? And he answers that in the first seven verses. He says, no, of course not. You shouldn't deprive one another. Sexual intimacy is within the bounds of marriage. Man and wife is perfectly acceptable and expected, really, is what he's saying. Should Christians married to non-Christians separate? That was a big deal for them, because sometimes only one partner had come to faith, and that was causing all sorts of tensions, as it always does. And while he's very clear that Christians should marry Christians when that's possible, if you were already married, he makes it very clear that there should be no separation, that every marriage has God's blessing upon it and can sanctify, can influence children and the other partner. They're asking him, well, can unmarried people get married? Because the time is short, they say. And he says, yes, they can, but he puts a bit of a proviso on that that we'll look at in a moment. And then they say, well, what about people remarrying, widows remarrying? Is that permitted? And of course, the answer was yes to that. Now, their concerns really arise out of a wrong sense of expectation that later proved to be false. You see, they had this idea in the New Testament that Jesus was going to come back again in their lifetime. They were expecting the second coming of Christ while they were still alive. And they were saying the time is short. And there was pressure upon them. There was persecution to a degree. And they were concerned about that. And so they're saying, what about these things? These things matter because we've got to make the best use of the time. That sounds very admirable. It probably wasn't. It was used as an excuse in some ways by some of them at least. But that was a wrong expectation. Here we are 2,000 years later, and all we can say is that the return of Christ is nearer now than it was then. It's nearer than when we first believed, as the Bible puts it. And when Jesus comes back, he's not coming as a baby in a manger. He's not coming to demonstrate the love and mercy of God through his life and death and resurrection. He's coming instead, yes, to demonstrate the love and mercy, but within the context of judgment, to judge and recreate the world, to come as a king and set up his kingdom and to deal with those who oppose him. Our expectation is very different. You know, we don't generally in the church have a great expectation of the second coming, if we're honest. Interestingly enough, the early days of Pentecostal movement, the early part of the 20th century, they put a great deal of emphasis on the second coming. If you know anything of the history of Elim, it was the Elim Foursquare Gospel Alliance, And the four square principle was believing in Jesus as the Savior, the Healer, the Baptizer in the Holy Spirit, and the coming King. It was one of their sort of main fundamental beliefs. Now, it's still one of our main foundational beliefs, but I think the average Christian doesn't think in terms of the second coming of Christ. They think in terms of perhaps when they die, the kingdom of God being ushered in their experience. It's a very different attitude. We don't have the same problem that they have. But I was reading this week in my devotions in Luke's Gospel, chapter 10 and verse, where was it? It was verse, 21 and verse 11. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilences in various places. If we've had one thing this last year during COVID, it's been a pestilence. That phrase is hardly used in Scripture. It's only used on a couple of occasions. Interesting to look at it. And there is no doubt that signs of pestilences and plagues is one of the many signs that we expect before the second coming of Jesus. And I wonder, simply provoke that thought that we should be living more in readiness of Christ's return. In fact, in a sense, we should be living as though today was our last, while at the same time holding in tension the fact that we should plan for the future in case he tarries. We've got to somehow hold that tension. Many of us will have seen the film The Bucket List. And I want to suggest to you that when it comes to the bucket list, there's only one bucket list. You know the concept. The concept is the things you want to do before you kick the bucket, the things you want to do before you die. And for the Christian, there should just be one bucket list, one thing in it. Whatever we do, we should be living in right way in undivided devotion to the Lord. That's what Paul writes in this chapter, undivided devotion. We'll look at that a little bit later, perhaps. But there's a very great difference between a Christian disciple and a Christian believer. A Christian believer may believe the right things about Christianity and about the gospel, might make some sort of profession of faith, but there isn't this priority to live in undivided devotion. There isn't this priority to put Christ first in our lives. That's really what the difference is between a believer and a disciple. And we ought to be people who are followers, wholehearted followers, wholehearted disciples of Christ. And in answering some of their questions, Paul answers some of our questions as well. So I'm going to do sort of a bullet point summary of some of the principles of marriage that I find in Scripture that aren't necessarily in this passage, but we're just going to whiz through them very quickly because I think some of them are relevant to each one of us. The backdrop of the marriage in their culture was very simple. Jews got married at 18. That was expected, that was normal. To be on the Sanhedrin, the ruling council of the Jews, you had to be married. So Paul, who had cast his vote on the Sanhedrin, was almost certainly married at that time. We don't know whether his wife died or whether she separated when he became a Christian and left him. We've no idea at all. All we do know is that all the time he was ministering, he was living as a single, celibate man. And like Jesus, singleness is a perfectly acceptable form of lifestyle. We've got to be very clear that marriage is not some better state than singleness. What's important is that we live in undivided devotion to the Lord, whether married or single. In Greek thought, in Jewish thought, it was just expected. Every man and woman got married wherever possible. But there were some occasions where rabbis and teachers of the law would not marry, and they would, the only acceptable reason for that really was to devote yourself to the study of the Old Testament law, the Torah. Epictetus in the Greek culture, which Corinth was steeped in, Epictetus had a very different attitude. His attitude was very simply, when he was asked why he never married, he said, "I'm a philosopher. How can one whose function it is to teach mankind be expected to heat the water to give the baby its bath? I'm above menial tasks," is what he's saying. He refers to children in a pretty derogatory way. He refers to them as let me get this quote right because it amused me, ugly-nosed brats. Ugly-nosed brats, that's how he referred to them. He had this idea that somehow as a philosopher he was above all of those mundane, everyday things. And of course, for women, in the culture of the day, there were very few that had any personal income, and so their security, because they didn't have the same status for the most part as men, their security was found in a marriage and family situation. It was a necessity in that culture. The only reason for not being married was to be devoted to a cause. If you were devoted to something like teaching the law or a philosopher, then it was acceptable not to be married. But for the Apostle Paul, for him, singleness is regarded as just as important an option as marriage. That's so important, because I think in church life, so many people who are single sometimes feel second class or living waiting for something to happen. And we need to be very clear that that isn't the case biblically. But we also need to recognize that people today ask a very different question. They don't ask, should I marry? They should ask questions like, why should I marry? What's the point of marriage? And marriage is beleaguered in our culture. And we ought to be doing everything we can to support it and to encourage it, because, of course, as far as the scripture is concerned, sexual intimacy is only between a man and woman within a committed relationship of marriage. It's not living together, it's not common law partnerships, it's a marriage relationship. And we could say much more on that, and of course I've touched on that in recent weeks already. But there's a second issue for Christians, and it is this, and it's a hard one, and we've got to be very honest about it. The problem for many single Christians is that the Bible tells us that whoever we marry has to belong to the Lord. And there is a disparity in the church, generally, between men and women. And so it's women, single women in the church, who struggle with this more often than single men. But it is a very real difficulty, and it ultimately becomes a faith issue. Some, in their desire for children, in their desire for a relationship, choose to marry non-Christians. They get into a courtship relationship, and the danger of that is it goes too deep, and then they're in and married before they've had chance really to be honest in assessing that. And that's a real problem and a very genuine issue for people. But ultimately, it comes down to faith. Am I in undivided devotion to the Lord? Am I willing to trust God that He has my best needs at heart? Am I willing to stand firm on these principles? There's a value in singleness. There's a value in singleness. And in our sex-crazed society, that's, you know, just dismissed. The thought is that anybody who isn't having sex regularly is abnormal. Of course, that's the public portrayal. It's not always the private fact. But nevertheless, we need to recognize that singleness is a valid option. Paul speaks in these verses about the gift of marriage and the gift of celibacy, the gift of sexual abstention. But his comment above all else is that God doesn't do these things or teach these things to restrict us. It's for our own good. He makes that very clear. I think it's in the 35th verse, if my memory serves me correctly. But let's understand some things about marriage. Bullet points from a biblical worldview. Well, first of all, let's recognize what marriage won't do. It won't resolve past problems. If you have problems from previous relationships or previous lifestyle, you'll bring them with you into marriage. Getting married won't solve all the problems. It won't bring total satisfaction and contentment. It won't complete you. You know, if I find the right partner, somehow I'll be whole. You're whole in Christ. And the whole principle of coming to faith in Christ is that God meets our deepest needs. Now, sometimes he does that through other people and through relationships, but we must not depend on those things. It doesn't make us more spiritual or more Christian to be married. It doesn't always resolve the pain and fear of loneliness. If you think that's the case, you've never sat with people with marriage difficulties who find themselves in a lonely relationship within their marriage, who struggle to work out what to do in that situation. It doesn't always prevent sexual temptation. In fact, it probably never prevents sexual temptation. If you're sexually tempted as a single, you'll be sexually tempted as an adult. As an adult, I didn't mean that. In a marriage relationship. And you have to handle temptation the same as you do in any situation. It doesn't mold your spouse to what you want them to be. Gail married me thinking she was going to get somebody who was perfect in every way, and she almost did, but even I have a few flaws. And you know them all too well, all of you, and Gail as well, without a doubt. Understand some things about marriage. You know, those of you who are single, if you're waiting for the one who will be your true love forever, that's an unbiblical concept. If you're in cell groups, you get the chance to debate that this week. But I want to suggest to you that the whole principle of arranged marriages in Scripture and the whole principle of arranged marriages in life, you can grow and learn to love if there's a mutual commitment to that. We are in a society where physical and emotional attraction is elevated too high and is not always long-lasting. And we need to recognize that there is not just one person who is going to make us happy. It takes hard work, it takes commitment, it takes mutuality. I have a friend, he's in Australia now. He came over here as a Sri Lankan student in around about 1978, something like that. He lived here 9 years as a student, and just when he was going to get British citizenship, if he'd stayed another year, they sent him home, and he had to emigrate to Australia. Just before he went, I remember talking to Ajit about his marriage, and we were talking about partners and life partners, and he said to me, "My home pastor and my parents will arrange my marriage." His parents weren't fully committed Christians, and so the pastor was brought in. That's a frightening thought for some of us, isn't it? And so the pastor was brought in alongside his parents to arrange a marriage for him. He and his wife have been married, I don't know, must be about 40 years now, mustn't it? Have two beautiful daughters. I was trying to think if they'd got a third there that I didn't know about, because I'm always the last to know. But they've got two beautiful daughters, and they are very much, very clearly committed and happy and in love. It was arranged for them. She's somewhat younger than him. And all I'm saying is, we mustn't commit ourselves to the idea that emotional and physical attraction and our Western culture is somehow right or biblical. It isn't. And we need to face up to these facts. Then let's move on very rapidly. Where am I up to on my list? It's slightly different in my notes. Sexual incompatibility. It's a lie. Won't say any more. We'll just move on. It's communication that's the issue in most marriages. Trial marriages don't work. The statistics for people living together and breaking up is far higher than for those who get married without having slept together. There's not just one person who's our soulmate. If there was, how could you ever hope to remarry after the death of a partner or something like that? You make it work. You commit to that. If you have problems in the early years of your marriage and don't work them out, they will come back to bite you. Why is it people get divorced sometimes after 15, 20 years of marriage or longer? It's because the issues in the early days were not dealt with soon enough and not handled and not worked through soon enough. And Paul makes it very clear that marriage is a partnership of equals. You know, if you want to talk about male headship in the context of Scripture, you've got to understand it properly. And the people who quote it, generally men, generally are just using it to justify getting their own way. And it's a mutuality. Paul speaks in verse 5 about sexual intimacy, and he says, don't deprive each other, because the woman could deprive the man just as much as the man deprived the woman, and it's a mutuality. He speaks about a wife must not separate from her husband. The implication is she has that right in that culture. There's a mutuality here. In conclusion, let me really rush this. The big issue is not the state we're in, whether we're married or whether we're single. The big issue is the danger of distraction. If you commit your life to Christ, if you are living for Jesus, then he demands first place in your life. And there's a danger of allowing relationships to get in the way of that, to distract us. We're called to live in a right way, it says, free from concern in verse 32. Living in a right way in undivided devotion to the Lord in verse 35. It's important that God comes before our spouse. And that should be true for Christian wives and Christian husbands. God comes first, without a shadow of a doubt. And our commitment to him means more than our commitment to one another. We come across Martha and Mary in the pages of Scripture, don't we? Luke's Gospel, chapter 10. And you know the story. Mary's sitting at Jesus' feet. She's always found at Jesus' feet on three occasions in Scripture. To the smell of food being prepared, she's there listening to his word. When a brother's dead and the smell of decay is in the air, she falls at Jesus' feet and shares her grief. And with the sweet smell of perfume as she breaks this expensive jar on him, she worships. Martha, on this occasion, is preparing the food for him to eat. She's distracted. It wasn't the fact that she was serving Jesus instead of sitting at his feet that mattered. It was the focus. What was she doing it for? She gets distracted by the preparation instead of remembering who she's feeding and why she's doing it. It's a bit like me sitting in the service here. You know, with all the technicalities and everything else, there was a bit of a problem on YouTube here that I picked up and the tech team did as well. And it's so easy for me in those early stages of worship in our church to get distracted with the mechanics instead of the focus of who we're worshiping. And it's easy for us in our daily life, in every situation, to allow others to get in the way, to allow other issues to get in the way. We're called to keep our focus on Jesus. So what does a devoted life look like? What does a life of undivided devotion look like? Well, first of all, it's a life built upon Christ's love for us. A love that ultimately sent him to the cross to die, to take our place on the cross, to redeem us, to forgive us, to set us free. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. It's based upon that. It's faith in his goodness and mercy towards us, even when a situation is non-ideal, even when we're struggling in it, even when it seems as though there's no way out and we seem to be stuck in a bit of a dead-end situation. It has some priorities that are obvious. Well, it has a daily life of worship and thanksgiving. It has a regular church involvement, not just watching a video, not just attending, but a commitment to it, a commitment to people. It's a life which serves others more than is self-serving. We're called to love God and to love others as ourselves. It can be measured very easily. If you want to know what your values are, look at your bank statement, look at your diary. Time and money and what you spend those on are a clear indication of where your heart is. If you don't use your money for the service of God, and your time for devotion and serving him, then it's a clear indication that your discipleship is awry in some way or other. And it starts every day by a commitment to Christ, a coming to the cross, a receiving of grace. And it's repeated every day. It doesn't matter that you made a commitment to Christ years ago. That's not adequate. Today, I've got to be following Jesus. Today, you have to be following Jesus. You were bought at a price, says Paul in verse 23. Don't become slaves of men. Don't become slave to anything else. Jesus paid the price on the cross for you to redeem you, to buy you back from sin and bring you back into a relationship of undivided devotion, whatever your circumstances. Let's stand together and pray. And as we pray, if you've got to collect children from 240 Tribe, this is the time to go and get them. Father, have your hand upon us. Enable us to live a life of undivided devotion to you. Help us to understand what that means for us in our individual circumstances and situation. Help us to know what it is to serve you and to walk with you in holiness and in truth. Help us to grasp that and to live that out in our relationships, in our involvements with others, in everything we do. For the glory of your name, we ask it. Amen. Amen. The band are going to come and close for us. You know, we're not allowed to mingle in the building, or we're not supposed to these days. Despite the rule of six, it doesn't apply to a place of worship, so we're not supposed to stay and mingle, but it's a beautiful day out there. Go out there, take your mask off, make sure you chat with each other, make sure any visitors among us are made welcome, because we don't have much opportunity to welcome them in other ways at the moment. So please do that. Helen is just going to come and close in prayer after we've sung this next song. Thanks, Helen.
I used to like that poster that we had outside that said, read your Bible every day and avoid truth decay. Let's sing this song, Water You Turned Into Wine.
Water you turned into wine. Us. And if our God is with us, who could stand against? And if our God is for us, who could ever stop us? If our God is with us, then what could stand against? Nothing. Oh. Oh. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger.
out this morning with that truth that you are greater, you are stronger, you are, you've got more power than anything that we face. And so as we face things this week, Lord, I pray that we'll just know you and know your power and your strength with each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.